Okay, cool. So in case you didn't realize, I'm Billy Thompson, and primarily actually I'm a developer. I'm what you might call a reluctant DevOps engineer though. I kind of get roped into doing DevOps stuff because I know a little bit about how to configure Nginx and a little bit about Docker containers. Therefore, it's my job to make sure that the dev team actually has something to run their code on. Okay, so I work at the home office. And just recently, we've started using some really cool new tools. So we started using Docker that you've heard of quite a lot about tonight. So I won't go into loads of detail about how that works. I'm sure you're already feeling pretty pumped up about it. You're going to run it in production tomorrow? Yeah? Cool. OK. So the other tool that has been mentioned that we use in production is Kubernetes. We use Kubernetes to manage a cluster of Docker hosts, essentially. So there's a few key, I'm not going to talk too much exactly about the details of this, but there's a few key things that you need to know about Kubernetes. So Kubernetes has basically three basic primitives. So you have pods. So pods are one or more Docker containers. So if you think maybe Apache is a Docker container, that's an entire service, that could be a pod. Or maybe if you're running PHP FPM and you need something to serve fast CGI as well from there. So you can run those two containers together of pod as a unit of scale. Also, another one of the primitives is a replication controller. Replication controller says, run this pod at least this number of times, and if it crashes, then start it again, which is pretty handy. So it makes sure that you're always running a stable number, at least two, presumably, of each of your services, so you can get some level of availability. And finally, we have services. Now, services are a really cool thing in Kubernetes, and I think they solve a massive problem with Docker. And that is, so I've got these three different containers running on five different hosts. How the hell do I know where they're actually running without running on every single host? So services will point to pods. They'll only point to pods which are actually running at the moment. So it allows you to give a handy DNS name to a running pod, so you can go like, connect me to my front end Nginx container, connect me to my SSL terminating container, whatever you want. It works on a round robin basis. So that's the basics of Kubernetes. Nodes is what you call a Kubernetes node. I think we're all pretty familiar with this. All of this goes into lovely YAML files that you can commit into your Git repository. Okay, so that's the basics of Kubernetes, because I didn't want to go into too much about this. So I'm going to talk tonight about the kind of the cultural changes that we put in place in order to actually use these tools effectively. So firstly, I'm going to cover why exactly and the business case for using these tools. Why exactly are we using them? What's the problem that we're trying to solve? So if you need to sell using these tools to your boss tomorrow at work, which I'm sure you're going to do, then you can use these arguments and explain this is where the gap is in your infrastructure. And then I'm going to talk about how exactly we're using these tools, what the philosophy that we're using these tools behind these tools is. And then I'm going to talk about how we implemented the cultural change needed to get our DevOps into a place where we're really using them effectively. And then finally, if I've got time at the end, I don't want to drag on too long, I'm going to give you some tips that you can use like tomorrow on your Docker containers to make sure that they're actually secure. Okay, so why? I was a little bit worried that you might not be able to see the... cool, so DevOps sucks at reuse, or at least it did at the home office. So DevOps has historically had a little bit of a problem. There's been a whole bunch of false starts when it comes to trying to get DevOps into a place where it's actually creating units which you can reuse when you move from system to system. So if I kind of talk you through the history of this, so originally we have packages. So packages are fantastic. They go away and get you a binary or a source, all the source files that you need, and it'll pull in the dependencies, and maybe it'll have a little bit of example configuration with it as well. So that's kind of cool. It's certainly easy to share, but you don't really get any application isolation. So if you need to run the application on a host with something which shares the same port, or perhaps needs to have a different version of a library that this package needs, that's not really going to work. And also, they don't have standardized configuration. So Nginx configuration is a hell of a lot different from Apache, from MySQL. They're all really hard. So in order to solve this standardized configuration problem, to create a nice, easy way that we could maybe share these packages and get them configured easily, we started using configuration management tools. So we started using Ansible, Puppet, Chef, I think there's about 5 million others, SaltStack. So there's loads out there. And this is kind of cool, except they still don't really solve this top problem. We can't run our application in isolation. We've still got the problem where applications can conflict with each other on the same host, which limits your ability to reuse applications right next to each other. Okay, so I'm sure the next question is, what about VMs? Because VMs do come pretty close. So VMs give you brilliant isolation. They're a little bit slow because they try and emulate right from the CPU, which is kind of slow, but they are quite easy to share. You can send around, VDI files to other people and have them run, and they get them up and running. But they don't offer you any standardized way of configuring them. So you're still back to using Puppet and things like this. Now, this was kind of until now. So we've got a really cool tool now, which solves all of these problems, and that is Docker. So Docker solves the application isolation problem. It's nicely isolated at the kernel level, which means that you can run many different versions of libraries on the same host and not worry about that conflict. You can run things which run on the same port on the same host. It's fantastic. And you also get the standardized configuration because everything is passed in with the minus E and it sets environment variables inside the container, which makes life really, really easy. So we've got standardized configuration. And finally, they're really easy to share because you can build them and you can push them to the official Docker registry, and it's fantastic, and all your friends can use them, and it's awesome. Okay, so that's kind of the basic tools. So we've got Docker there. That's kind of how we're using it, creating things which are isolated, reusable units. So how are we actually using this? So what we're doing is, so what happened was we started going away when we came to starting to use this really cool tool, Docker. We're like, okay, so how can we actually get our developers using this? And you start thinking, okay, so what is a developer's most preferred way of running code? So if you talk to a few people, they go, well, you know, I don't really like to worry too much about the DevOps, especially if I'm just doing stuff initially. I just like maybe stick it on Heroku or use Amazon's Elastic Beanstalk. I just get it up there and don't worry too much about exactly how I deploy it. Maybe if it becomes a real thing later, I'll do something more proper. Now, so this is clearly the first go-to application, the go-to thing for developers for a pleasant development experience. And we want our developers to have a pleasant development experience. So we started thinking, oh, these are my attempts at naming the project. None of these actually happened. I think it's DSP it's called now, which is a bit disappointing, really. So we started thinking about the things that we wanted from the past that we were going to create. So we want to have a standard interface. So at the home office, we're really big on security. And sometimes that means that we can't necessarily run everything on the public cloud. So maybe we've got some machines which are running on like vSphere and things like that. So we want our pass to work just as well and exactly the same on vSphere as they would on AWS, so we can reuse stuff. We want components, which Docker gives us nicely, and we want this to be flexible. We don't want to be tied into only being able to make web applications. We want to be able to do cool build pipelines and informatics and stuff like that as well. So we found something which we think fits this bill really, really well, which is Kubernetes. Ta-da! So Kubernetes offers us a standard API and suite of tools that developers can use to launch applications on our internal PaaS. And it doesn't matter whether they're launching on our AWS PaaS or whether they're launching it on our like vSphere PaaS or one of the other ones that we've got kicking about there. It's all the same interface. So it's a nice standardized thing. Because we have Docker containers, we now have nice reusable, shareable components that everyone can get behind using, and it's fantastic. And obviously, it's pretty flexible because of the way that I've mentioned about how we have pods and services. Like, that's pretty much open to implementing any kind of network infrastructure, more or less, inside your Docker cluster. Okay, so because we're also thinking like a PaaS, and we've got really lazy developers, and we don't want to have to deploy the same thing over and over again to our Docker clusters, we provide a whole bunch of pre-configured services, just like AWS do or Heroku. So we offer GitLab, Jira, databases, Drone.io, which you can tell everyone all about. it's working really well. Okay, so and we also have persistent storage, which is like S3, but a bit more secure because of the government, and we have paranoid people who work in our offices. Okay, so that's kind of what we do with this. We have these pre-configured, and they're either YAML files and Docker containers we can just start up, or they are services which people can just use and have got a nice endpoint. So we got all this stuff in place, but unfortunately, this kind of wasn't the end of the story. So actually, people weren't necessarily creating lovely Docker containers and then getting everyone to reuse their code and share it. We found that actually, largely, people stuck to the way they were doing things before. So they would create things on a per application basis. They would redo everything every single time they came to a new environment, which obviously is not great when we've got all this stuff to help you share and reuse ops code really, really easily. So we thought, what's the best way to solve this problem? And like everyone does when they come to see a problem, they're like, right, whose idea can we steal? So obviously the first place that we looked was the open source community, because even the most staunchly closed source projects, which hate all open source and things like that, if you like, for example, Microsoft famously using the BSD network kernel, or Adobe, if you ever look in their licenses thing, there's loads of GPL stuff in there. Okay, so what we did is we thought we would steal some of their principles. In order to get developers and DevOps people inside the home office sharing and creating reusable containers. So the first thing that we thought we would do is we'd just get everyone to... Sorry.
3 minutes.
Oh, cool. Oh, I was like, shit, I forgot all about that. cool, thanks. Okay, so the first thing that we thought we would do is we would just tell people that... well, we're going to flan all the... authorization structure for GitLab and GitHub. All you have to do is work as a developer or a DevOps person at the home office, and you'll be able to see everyone's code. You'll be able to see everyone's containers. Unfortunately, this didn't really work. People, like, just because you have loads of repositories that you can see doesn't mean that things are in a fit state for them to be reused by other teams, which is, I'm sure, a problem that you've all come across when you try to pick up a new project which was developed on by someone else, and it's kind of like, oh, shit. Obviously, that never happens to me. So what we started doing was we started choosing some of the best of these, and we started open sourcing them. And what we found was this actually encourages people to be good people. So what I mean by this is it convinces people to version stuff, to write beautiful, or at least some, documentation for all their applications, to publish licenses. We use GPL v2. It's pretty cool. And also to set a code of conduct so everyone knows that anyone can contribute to these repositories without fear of being discriminated against. And while these are really cool things to have on your open source projects, the more things that you open source, the more things that you find that you, the more that you find you develop a culture of your closed source things having the same properties. So, and these properties are things that you need for all of your projects. So you need to know that when you follow a version of something, that actually the next version, if it's a minor version, isn't going to break backwards compatibility. These are all really useful things. You need to be able to look at the documentation and work out what the hell something's actually supposed to be doing when you're trying to use it in your infrastructure. This is particularly true of DevOps stuff, which is quite frequently very opaque. And obviously publishing licenses and setting codes of conduct. It makes it more likely that people will contribute. And if people contribute to your open source stuff, that's less work that you have to do. So being a good person inside and also outside of the organization can have a massive influence on how reusable your code actually is. So just before I come into the security stuff really quickly, I've got some little conclusions. So firstly, I would strongly recommend that you move to Docker, you start open sourcing components of your infrastructure and releasing them as proper projects. It will improve your organization's image because obviously what's the first thing that you do when you go look at a company that sounds really cool? Go look on their GitHub account. Well, this is what I do. Go look on their GitHub account and check out if they've got any decent open source stuff. It allows you to reduce DevOps rework, which was initially this was the primary aim of doing all this, and this wouldn't be possible without having good documentation, reusable containers, and just generally usable code. And finally, it gives us happy developers, because developers no longer see DevOps as like a bottleneck and like, oh, I've got to wait for DevOps to provision this. It's something that happens. It's already up and running. They're empowered to make changes to it so they can just stick stuff on Kubernetes. They can release their own Docker containers. It makes them a lot happier and a lot more able. It makes me happier, and I'm a developer. Okay. So I'm going to give you some security tips. So we've had a really cool presentation talking about practical security tips when you're running Docker. But these are some things when you're designing your Docker file. Okay, so there's some really, really simple tips here. So firstly, use an application firewall. Docker's really cool. It protects the process. Doesn't protect you from data coming into the application through a TCP port, through a HTTP endpoint. So stick an application firewall in it. There's one on the home office GitHub repository. We call it the Nginx proxy, and it comes with the Naxxis plugin for Nginx on there. So you can turn that on and set up some filtering rules for your application. And I know like lots of people write awesome code and they never put any security vulnerabilities in it, but sometimes, you know, the framework you're using, definitely not my code, has a security bug in it, and like you need to protect against that upcoming situation. Finally, controlling your upstream containers is really important as well. So I think it was Docker Hub or someone did a scan of all the packages which were installed in Docker containers that they had in their registry, and it's something like 80% of them had major security vulnerabilities. So it's really important to know which containers you're extending from, and so that at the very least you can just trigger a rebuild to pull in the latest changes which are in your upstream container. We have a single base image where we know that we have at least a reasonably up-to-date image and that we can extend off that with knowing that we're not going to get security vulnerabilities in there. And finally, all this reuse stuff is really cool and having separate environments that you can deploy to, but sometimes physical separation of your hosts, regardless of how awesome and massive your Kubernetes cluster is, actually pretty important. You don't want to create a really juicy target with loads of really cool data in and really cool interlinks to supposedly secure systems, because that's just asking to be hacked. And the more things that you run on it, the more security vectors it's got in there. So sometimes you do need to separate your host just to create a little bit of a less juicy target for people to break into, and obviously mitigate embarrassment if you do get broken into.